Well, depending on where you are in the world, good afternoon, good evening, good morning. It's Word Balloon. It's Baltimore Comic Con on live. So happy to be here. John Suntress, every day of this convention is like Christmas for me because I get to talk to my friends. And I get to talk to one of my good friends across the ocean. We see each other less frequently than the Olympics happen. It's Mark Millar. It's great to see you, buddy. How are you?
Fantastic, actually. You know, I mean, it's funny. We're in a sort of semi-lockdown again in Scotland. I know it's different all around the world what's happening, you know, but like our pubs are closed. And I think that was like, that psychologically for Scottish people, that's been a disaster. The pubs are closing at 6 o'clock, 6 p.m. So we've all started drinking at breakfast time. We're getting up and then the pub at 11 a.m. just to make this work for us, you know, but it's tough times.
Well, we are opening Miller's Pub for the next hour or so, and I have my cocktail in hand.
I've got my Irish cocktail in hand.
Lovely. Cheers to you. Great to see you, my man.
And I've told everyone who's tuning in to have a six-pack beside them for the whole hour, and we'll all have a drink together. We can't actually – one of the best things about a convention is when we all meet in the bar, isn't it? It's lovely. Readers, you know, writers, artists, everyone, we just all get there and we all just like talk crap all day, you know? Yeah. And this is kind of as close to that as we're going to get, isn't it? We can all at least have a drink together.
I'm sure a lot of us are all over the world having virtual drink-ups with our buddies and stuff like that. And it's a great opportunity to catch up with you and talk about some of the amazing things that are going on with you, with not only comics, but also your great production deal with Netflix. We are all eagerly awaiting Jupiter's Legacy. Am I right? It's Legacy or Circle?
I'm watching it, Jupiter's Legacy.
It is Legacy.
Yeah, I'm watching it every day, which is so weird. I do feel quite spoiled. I saw The Kingsman 6 months ago, and you know, I'm watching Jupiter's Legacy every day. I mean, this is one of the beautiful things about being a producer. You can get to see it a bit early, you know. And in this editing process, when all the special effects have been added, like every week, there's like a new little tweak to it, so you get to sit and watch it again. And technically, it is work, even though you're sitting there for 8 hours, having the time of your life watching this stuff. It's still technically work. You get paid for it, which is good. But it's looking great. I mean, I'm loving it. It's looking fantastic.
That's excellent, man. We were talking a couple hours ago, and you were telling me the effects look great. And it's so great, Mark, because I think back to when Bendis, had his streaming show, Powers. Yeah. And, you know, again, for television, they looked okay. Yeah. But it's a different world, man. 5 years later, I mean, my God, the effects are incredible and film quality.
Well, this is a super expensive show. I mean, this is up there with The Crown and all that kind of stuff. Is like the money has really been spent on this. So do I, actually. I really like it. But like, it's $100 million show. I mean, this is enormous. This isn't like, you know, most comic book television. I mean, Marvel shows haven't cost anything like this. The ones that have been on at Netflix. And it's there. It's actually like you're watching a Marvel movie. It's like that goes on for 8 hours. I mean, this is really high quality stuff. And the writing is fantastic. Amazing high level actors. It's so sophisticated. I almost can't believe that it's mine because it's so sophisticated.
Well, I'm thrilled for you, and I do want to talk about the TV show and the cast because, first of all, it was a great comic. You and Frank did such a beautiful job in Jupiter's Legacy and Jupiter's Circle, and it's really, really exciting. And as we've talked about in previous conversations, what a great opportunity to tell your story on such a wide canvas of, you know, multiple hours in each season rather than a 2 or 3, even 3 hour movie.
Yeah, it's funny because I think my stuff tends to lend itself quite well to a movie. Like the structure of Kingsman works well as a 3-act structure movie. You know, the kid has nothing, the kid trains up, the kid is James Bond by the end of the movie, and Kick-Ass and all these things all follow up. A nice movie structure for 2 hours. But Jupiter's Legacy was funny, and it was James Gunn, the genius who did Guardians. I don't think I've ever said this publicly, but James Gunn looked at it and he said, this is not a movie. He said, this is a brilliant television show. He said, there's too much complexity to it for it to be a 2-hour movie. And something that's a really critical flashback that we can spend a whole hour on in the television show would have to be 2 minutes of a movie or 90 seconds of a movie. So to be able to do it so layered is great. I mean, as ever, James Gunn is right.
I understand. You know, what does Vaughn think? I mean, your continual film collaborator and stuff. Yeah. What did he think about the TV move?
Well, Matthew, funnily enough, I've actually given him a sneaky look at the first episode. He's seen episode one. He loves it. You know, like,
That's great. He was
last night. I mean, he and I, although I'm at Netflix and he's over at Fox Disney, you know, doing Kingsman just now.
Okay.
And I technically can't work on Kingsman because I'm a Netflix employee. I'm an executive at Netflix then.
Sure.
He and I talk every day, though, and I know everything that's going on over there and everything, you know, so we gossip all the time. So he's been really excited about this for ages. And it's kind of weird because we're so used to working together. But he and I first started talking in 2007, I think. And we've talked almost every day since 2007. So it's kind of weird that he's almost watching this as a fan, you know?
Yeah.
But we're talking about doing something together. I mean, I'm trying to lure him away from Disney and get him over to Netflix, which would be awesome. I mean, Netflix is the place to be. You don't want to be at Disney.
That's and right now, honestly, as COVID has paralyzed so much of the entertainment world, it's the streamers that are best positioned to churn out new content. They you know, really catalog and stack that stuff up to slowly put out. So they're in the best advantageous position. We were talking again earlier, you know, buddies of ours like Greg Rucka have a home run with The Old Guard, his Charlize Theron movie. And it's really been fascinating watching the TV and motion pictures that have been streaming lately. It's all high quality stuff.
Yeah, it's great. I mean, it used to be the stuff that was streamed was the stuff that studios didn't want, wasn't it? It was the stuff they weren't going to make a buck on in the cinemas. But now the stuff that's been made is great. And Netflix, I think, anticipated 3 years ago that Amazon were going to up their game. We all knew Disney Plus was coming and everything. So Netflix used to be almost the only game in town. But now there's so many competitors now, and you've got amazing stuff like The Boys on Amazon. You've got Lord of the Rings coming. Paper Girls, I think, is coming to Amazon and all that. You know, so there's a lot of really good stuff coming. So Netflix bought our company in 2017 for that reason. So they bought 17 franchises and with the company, and they own the company now. I mean, a lot of people think it's a first look deal or something, but they actually own the company, and we all get bought out. And then as a separate deal, they asked me to come on and create stuff in-house, create movies and TV shows and things. So I think right now we're actually on franchise 22 or 23 or something. I mean, it's preposterous, right? So, like, but Netflix just want to destroy everybody that comes at them next year with all this good stuff. So it's exciting, you know. I mean, COVID has obviously delayed a lot of things and held them up for everyone, you know. But, but you know, it's the same all over, really, you know. So I think most of these shows will be hitting, I guess, a year or so down the line. Jupiter's, though, is up early next year.
Okay, that's great, because, several people are already asking, like Dan, when it's dropping. So, yeah, early next year, everybody. That's what's going on. Chris Noeth, who you might know from your Millarworld message boards, he's got a long question here. As a longtime Millarworlder, I have two comic projects ready, created with a team, with me writing them, and now want to ask what Mark thinks makes more sense, submitting the creator-owned projects to publishers or doing crowdfunding in these difficult days? And that's a great question, and it's one that has been a continuing conversation on Word Balloon as well. So yeah, I'm really interested in your thoughts on all this.
I would 100% say crowdfunding. Crowdfunding, definitely. It's a very, very competitive and crowded creator-owned market just now as well. You know, so I think creator-owned monthly books, a lot of them are struggling. I mean, a lot of them aren't hitting 3,000, 4,000, 5,000 sales, which you kind of really need to break even and do well in it. If I was still doing my own stuff instead of working for a company, I'd 100% go in the crowdfunding route. And then you just sell it again anyway. You know, you just bring it out from a company later and publish it as a book too, you know. But it's free money, so don't, never turn down free money.
That's a amen. Thing, you know? What do you think, Mark, as we talk about the comic book business for a second, what do you think about the fate of the monthly magazine format?
Oh, it's inevitably going to be here still forever, you know. I mean,
okay.
Again, like, it's exciting to be able to read everything all at once, but you have to think about it from a business point of view, you know, just from an actual company point of view. Joe Quesada, I remember, said this years ago, people used to say, why don't you do original graphic novels? And Joe says, I'd rather sell it twice. Joe said, you could sell it as a monthly and then you collect it and bring it as a graphic novel anyway. So you have that end product for the people who like reading that, but why lose out on the revenue of doing monthly books? It'd be insane, you know? So, and a lot of books, I think, would lose money if they just came out as original graphic novels. Like Kick-Ass is a great example. When we brought out Kick-Ass, I think our advanced orders on issue one was about 45,000 on issue one, but we ended up doing 128,000, I think it was, by the time you added up all the printings. We did about 7 printings of it. And that meant that we made, you know, a lot of money on the monthly books. And then there was an established audience had built up and some heat by the time the graphic novel came out, and we did 100,000 copies of the hardcover inside 8 weeks. And if we brought that out as just a $25 hardcover, we'd have done 2,000 copies if we were lucky, because nobody would have taken that you know, who'd take the risk on a $25 book they'd never heard of? So I think make it as cheap for people as possible. I even feel comics are too expensive. I'd love to see comics cheaper, you know. Like, I mean, I think companies, because the people who run the companies are well off, forget that people are cash sensitive. But I remember what it was like to go in with, you know, £5 in my hands, and I had to make a decision. There was 8 comics I wanted to buy, but I could only afford to buy 4 of them, you know, and I always remember that, you know?
No, buddy, I'm the same. It's from that same era. And as Tevya asked, and this is my wonder, and that's why I said the physical magazine, do you think comics will go digital in the future? And the physical, I don't know. I don't think they'll go away. Yes. I think physical comics might be just like vinyl music. Yes. And that real hardcore collectors will still want that paper product, but it may not be the mass product that it was 20 years ago.
Well, here's my perspective on it. I think it always goes in cycles anyway. You know, you tend to think comics has roughly a 20-year cycle. So, you know, you had 35 to 55, 55 to 75. It's a parabolic curve, you know, not to get too scientific about it, but if you can almost plot it on a graph in terms of sales, you know. And what tends to happen is that there's a new influx of readers comes in, and something brings in the new influx of readers, whether it's comic stores or whatever, you know. There's something at some point in these graphs, roughly every generation. And I think what digital is going to do is create the next wave of hardcore people, you know. So I think digital almost started too early, you know, like whenever it came out, not everybody had a device. And I think now pretty much everybody has a device. It's very rare to find a kid now that doesn't have a tablet. So so I think if they can drop the price of digital is still far too expensive, I think. But if you can drop the price of digital down and go international, make it a really, really big thing, I think you're going to bring in lots of people into paper comics, because you'll always get a hardcore fan base when something goes as wide as I think comics could go digitally. And you know, in anything, you know, there's a certain number of people who become fanatics like you and I, and I think that's the inevitable next step. So I think that'll happen over the next 3 or 4 years. I mean, I've always predicted a massive comic boom in 2026. And I think comic stores are going to do absolutely fantastic. I was saying this 10 years ago, right? You know, but I think 2026, there's going to be like a massive comic boom. It's going to be like crazy, and it'll run all the way to 2030 when it starts to taper off again. But I think that it's going to be digitally led this time, like properly digitally led. I don't think it'll be Comixology. I think, you know, there'll be something interesting is going to happen. And I think that you're going to have a whole new bunch of people coming into comic stores who'd never considered picking up a comic before.
Interesting. That's interesting you picked 2026. Certainly likely far enough away from COVID. So from that standpoint, I get it. Why 2026? That's interesting. Say 5-year cycles or whatever?
20-year cycles, you know.
20-year cycles, okay.
It tends to have an incline, a peak, and then, you know, it comes over the other side. You know?
Sure.
So that's a parabolic curve, essentially, you know. But it forms a sine wave whenever you look at the way the market goes. I mean, yeah. Listen, we're boring everybody to death with my theories here, you know, so we need to go into the cool stuff, you know.
Well, but you're not far off. And honestly, Mark, thinking back in the 15 years we've known each other, I do think back to our first conversations in 2006 when you were in the throes of Civil War and are like, you know, I'm really lucky right now. I'm, you know, between what you had done already at DC and what you were doing at Marvel, you're like, I'm not going to be here forever. Yeah. So I kind of have to, you know, make my move. And at the time, I'm like, where are you going? What the hell are you talking about? Yeah. And here we are. And seriously, it's been great, Mark. I'm so pleased for you. And truly, the work has been equal to the opportunities to transfer them from comics to film and television. And I really, man, it's been exciting being ringside and watching all this stuff happen for you.
Well, thanks very much. But I mean, so much of it is luck as well and being in the right place at the right time. I mean, this is, again, part of my crazy graph theory. If I'd been born 10 years earlier or 10 years later, I wouldn't have had the opportunities, because I think, you know, the peaks, like I say, tend to come roughly around the middle of every other decade. So like 1966, 1986, 2006, 2026, there tends to be these peaks. And unfortunately, you know, if you're born at the wrong time, you don't sort of... Oh, sorry, what am I...
Not a problem, buddy.
Calling again? Do you know what Roblox is?
No, Roblox, or what are you saying?
Roblox is a kid's game. And it's no, all totally. Online, right? And my 8-year-old daughter like plays all the time, right? And our friends are calling all the time.
Oh, this that's awesome.
We have in the house. Yeah, yeah. Sorry about that. So yeah. But like, yeah, basically, you know, if you're born at the right time, you can be lucky enough to ride a wave, you know? So like if Stan Lee hadn't been around in the 60s or Alan Moore and Frank Millar hadn't been around in the 80s, probably someone else could have capitalized on an emerging kind of interest in comics at the time. It was just going to happen anyway, you know? And luckily we happen to have geniuses there at that point. But I just think I've been incredibly lucky just at the time where they'd run out of Marvel books to adapt. They suddenly start looking for creator-owned stuff, and I just happen to be a guy that has a lot of creator-owned stuff lying around at the time. So, you know, I never get too big-headed about it. I always think I'm extremely lucky. I was lucky to be at Marvel when they did the Ultimate line, and we'd 5 years of being Marvel's top books, which was awesome. If I'd been at Marvel 5 years earlier, that would never have happened for me, you know? So it's a bit like Forrest Gump, you know, where there's some dope who sort of wanders in and lucks out now and then. I think I've just been awfully lucky.
I've referred to myself as Forrest Gump when it comes to my broadcasting career and the opportunities that I've got. I'm like, hey, man, I'm a foot soldier in broadcasting. I'm like, I'm very lucky for the things that happen to me. So I get it. That's fantastic, man. A lot of people are wondering, and likely COVID is the answer, but yeah. I'm going to throw these questions up here in terms of Tiago Alves asks, you know, what about that lovely trailer for Jupiter's Legacy you talked about some weeks ago? I imagine that COVID kind of delayed the release of that trailer.
No, they're actually, no, they're fine-tuning it. Like, I saw the trailer, there's a teaser trailer, there's a full-length trailer, and then there's the show. And I've been sitting on them for weeks. It's awesome. You know, so I've just been sitting looking at them, and I cannot believe how cool they are. Even the teaser trailer is tiny, right? It's really small. It's under a minute. I think it's about 50 seconds or something. And even I was excited, and I've been watching the show like every week for months, you know, like watch the unedited version, you know, without the special effects and everything. But even I was excited by the teaser trailer. That's how good the trailer is, you know. And then the full length trailer is just fantastic. You know, it's great. And my kids are furious because my two youngest are 6 and 8. And they said, I can't wait to see this. When can we see it? And I was like, about 7 years. You know, it's you can watch the trailer, but, you know, 7 years for the show.
Mess with them. That's excellent.
Lockdown. There's a lot of sad stuff, obviously, with lockdown. So I try and find the couple of good things that have happened, you know. And one of the weird things that has happened is my kids have become obsessed with comic books, right? It's strangest things. And especially my 8-year-old, she just got into it. Yeah, and all I've got three daughters, and all of them like superheroes, and they go and see the Marvel movies and everything. But they've become obsessed with it, and I think it's because they've been locked in the house with me. So like they're not hanging out with their friends as much, you know, and like there's just comic stuff around all day. And when they're not in school, when they've been homeschooled, they're just seeing issues of The Flash and things lying around. So they're now like experts. It's unbelievable. Like, I genuinely heard them fight last week, and I was like, "What's going on?" And they said, "She said Brainiac's a level 9 intelligence. And I know he's a level 12." You know, it's like, I mean, that is the stuff that's going on in the house. It's like, I can't believe what's happening, but it's fantastic. I'm loving it.
That's excellent to hear. And you know, they released the North American bookselling numbers, and graphic novels are up. And honestly, a lot of it isn't Marvel or DC. It's a lot of this young adult stuff and manga and Diary of a Wimpy Kid and all that stuff. And you're right, man. No, this is, I mean, sadly, this is an extended rainy day period that we used to live through and curl up with our comics, and kids are doing it. So yeah, you're right. Maybe this is a new resurgence of the format of comics, yeah?
Yeah, and what's really fascinating is that my kids have really got into stuff that was out before I was born. So I'm fascinated by that, because they're not that interested in even 80s stuff or 90s stuff or 70s stuff. They're interested in 50s and 60s stuff. So being a massive fan, like I've got all the compendiums, you know, those big 500-page collections that I have.
Oh, yeah.
And the kids found this stuff, and then they get me to read it to them every night before bed. And they can read themselves now, but they're just lazy, you know, so they get me to read it to them at night. And my wife's like, what's going on here? Because they kind of have the taste of a 70-year-old man. You know? So, like, they love, their favorite Superman is, like, Wayne Boring's Superman and everything. I was like,
that's amazing. That's fantastic. Well, you know, honestly, Mark, that stuff was, as you know, written for a 10- to 12-year-old audience.
Yeah.
So that kind of makes sense. And I mean, you know, those were my storybooks when I was a little kid. And I really started reading in the 70s, new and reprint stuff. And luckily, especially here in the States,
Yeah.
They'd have those 100-page spectaculars where there'd be a front news story and then silver and even golden age stories. So I grew up loving the Justice Society as much as I love the League.
Absolutely. You know, and what's really interesting is that they have no sense that these are old stories. So there's a timeless quality. You know, when you're a kid, Cinderella or Sleeping Beauty, you know, it's just a story. You don't think, oh, well, that was written years ago, so I'm not into this. And the kids are like that. You know, they actually read this as if they're watching their current favorite Disney Plus show.
Sure. Absolutely, man. I mean, as I look over, I keep looking to see what people are asking, because I know this is a great opportunity for people to jump in and ask questions from you. Let's see here. Oh, here. So up to this point, what has been your most enjoyable story series that you've written, and which artist for your work has taken a series far beyond your expectations? Interesting question, Adam.
It's a really good one. I mean, I'm going to answer this, and I know I'm going to alienate all the other guys I've worked with. I've worked with maybe 25 big artists over the last 20 years, and I'm going to hurt everybody's feelings and say Olivia Coipel. Magic Order is the best experience I've ever had working in comics.
It's just
great. I mean, I loved writing it. I was really happy with it. Netflix were super excited about it. And Olivia drawing it, he made it look 500 times better than I saw it in my head. He's great. And he and I talked about working since I was in my 20s, you know, I mean, like years back. And I'd always been after him. And he'd always signed up with Marvel for something, you know, he was never available to create her own stuff. He was never available. And then suddenly it happened. And we finally, the stars aligned and we did Magic Order. So I've loved it. I've just finished book three. Book two is being drawn just now. And there's going to be four books in total. So, but I've really enjoyed doing that book. It's been fun. Jupiter's Legacy, I love doing too with Frank Quitely. I mean, Frank and I are neighbors. You know, we live in Glasgow together. So I know him so well for over 20 years now. And working with him is always brilliant too. But I'm lucky though. I mean, think about the guys I've worked with. I mean, it is crazy, isn't it? I mean, like, I showed you earlier. I mean, listen, by the way, just to point out to people, this isn't my office. This is upstairs in the house, you know, because one of the things I love about this is you get a little peek inside everybody's office, don't you? And you can see all the original art. And I do have loads of original art, but I showed you it earlier, but I can't, because the house is an old house, I can't get a signal in my office. So I've had to come upstairs. So don't think I don't have any original art. Anybody who's watching this, right? I love my comic book original art, but I've built a gallery downstairs of all the guys I've worked with. And it's crazy when I look at it. Joe Kubert's done my stuff. Steve Ditko's done my stuff, you know. I've had obviously Frank Quitely and amazing modern guys and everything as well. I've been crazy lucky.
Johnny Romita and Dave Gibbons and, you know, yeah, the like. No, it's been amazing, Mark. And truly, you know, we said this earlier, as you said, your connection died out. So I'm like, oh, we got to videotape you walking around. And then maybe, you know, on a future Mainframe or Word Balloon episode, we'll take a really good look at your studio, because you're right. I mean, trust me, folks, I saw it. It's amazing. And
Christopher Reeve's cape hanging up. And I mean, it's cool, honestly. But please don't think I'm this boring. This is not my office. It's like my office is cool. The guys I haven't worked with yet, Travis Charest and Adam Hughes, they're like the two gods I haven't worked with.
But that'd be great.
No, but I'm secretly working with Travis on something just now. Travis is already, he's halfway through a thing right now, which we've been working on for the last year or so. So that's exciting. So my run of crazy artist luck continues. So we've actually, I mean, before COVID, we decided to take this year off publishing. And we're not actually back in publishing until May next year. This was always our plan. We actually stopped in February last year. But when we come back, we've got some crazy stuff. We've got the sequels to Magic Order, Jupiter's, three new series, one of them with Travis Charest, you know, a new thing with Frank Quitely. There's some amazing stuff coming up. It's a really exciting couple of years.
That's excellent, man. People are asking about both the TV show of Jupiter's Circle, but also they also want to know about Jupiter's Requiem. I suppose that's the new arc that you're teasing for May. So we don't want you to spoil. I would imagine, I don't know what you can tell us about what's coming up.
Well, I've finished it. It's all done. It's 12 issues. 12 issues starting in May. This is all the big secrets. So it starts in May. Magic Order 2 starts in July.
Okay.
And the fifth volume of Jupiter's Legacy, which is called Jupiter's Requiem, it starts in May. It's going to be 12 issues long. There'll be a slight break. There'll be a three-month break between issue 6 and 7. So it's going to be two more graphic novels. And it goes 30 years into the future. So the first Jupiter storyline is set in the past. The next one's set in the present. and the final one is set in the future, but it goes a generation on, and everything's all explained. And that doesn't sound massively exciting right now, but see, once you've seen the show, you realize the backstory is so interesting, and they go into it with so much more space in the show. Now, the structure of the show is really great. It's been mentioned before, but half of it's set in the present day, and the other half of it's set in the past. And all that stuff is just absolutely awesome. But you need to buy all the books ahead of the show so you can really appreciate it and see what's been done with it. So there's four volumes just came out. We repackaged them and brought them out about 2 weeks ago. So if you go to your comic store, support your retailer and pick up those books because they're pretty good.
Absolutely, man. And I'm very excited for the TV show because, again, we've discussed this before. The fact that you can go back and forward and look at the origins of this superhero family of people and then also into the present and the future, what would have been in a three-hour movie, like you said, like a five-minute scene and stuff, now you can spend an hour if you want looking at something.
Well, that's it. I mean, the show starts in 1929, like the book, where you have the Great Depression and you have like the financial crash and then the superheroes, you know, these six people go off to find this mysterious island and come back with powers that save America. And, you know, the kind of the level of complexity they put into it is incredible. You know, they do the Wall Street crash in episode one and run through the 20s. And then season two, we'll move into the next period in history. We go through the 50s, the 60s, all this stuff. So it's like you've never seen a superhero thing like this. You know, even Marvel have never attempted anything on this grand scale. I mean, it's going to be five seasons, you know, 8 hours each time. So a 40-hour story here. I mean, this thing is, it's got scope. It's a universe really more than a franchise itself. It's an entire universe of characters. So I love it. I'm delighted my name is associated with it. It's great.
That's excellent, man. And I'm sure you're starting 8 years before Action Comics number one, or yeah, 9 years before. So that's cool too. I mean, it's I think this is a great opportunity to really explore the way history unfolded and what if there were superheroes alongside of it and what the impact could be on such significant, you know, things. I mean, obviously Watchmen did that to a degree, but really only handled 30 years. And you're obviously not only going up to the present, but going into the future with this.
And we go really deep. You know, there's a whole season in 1929, an entire season's in 1929. And what I love about this actually is historians, you know, historians always get everything wrong. So I love the idea that in 150 years, people are going to think that Jupiter's Legacy started in 1929. They're going to think Superman's a ripoff. Superman's a complete ripoff of my story. I love it because we were 9 years early.
That's hilarious. That's fantastic, man. Well, you know, it is Miller's Pub, and we do have the opportunity to give away a couple great snifters that we got from the people at Wiggle Liquor. And I'm sorry that I don't have the picture handy. I am like so unprepared today. I apologize. However, we do have a couple celebrities that want to ask a couple trivia questions of the audience. So, yeah, I want to everybody get ready and see if you can answer this first question from a former collaborator of Mark Millar's.
Hi, Mark. This is Dave Gibbons here. Wish I could be there with you personally, but I'm kind of busy. But I do have a trivia question for you. So here it is. Which other Mark makes an appearance in both the Secret Service comic book and the film, but not in the same part? For a bonus point, what is the character's name in the film? Hope you can figure it out. Cheers.
All right, cheers, Dave. And I, as a quizmaster, will demand that you not only answer what the celebrity is, but what his name was, which is different from the comic and the film. So we'll see if we get an answer to that. But I thought that was a pretty cool question.
That's a great question. Obviously, I know it. Am I allowed to answer this? Can I win this?
I'm sending you a brandy snifter regardless.
I could see it now. I'd be the first one in. I'd be the first one to win.
Yes, I want. We need the full name, everybody. And again, I'm sure people right now, all right, like getting out the smartphone. Don't cheat. Come on now. It's like a bar trivia thing, man. Come on. You're not supposed to use your phones. I want to see somebody really answer the question. But while we're waiting for the answer, we'll talk more. And let's see. No, I'm sorry. People are guessing, but not correct and not yet. But we'll get you.
Do you guys have bar quizzes in the States? Do you guys have that?
Oh, yeah. Oh, sure. Pub trivia. Absolutely, man.
Like, I used to pride myself in always being really good at those, right? So my friends and I would go along. But the worst thing that ever happened was a smartphone. because obviously people were cheating and they were like, somebody had a phone under the table, they'd always get the right answer. Now, I remember one time there was this crowd of guys in the pub who were the toughest guys I've ever seen, and they were getting like questions on 1920s jazz and everything. And I was like, my friends and I were like, do we go over and confront these guys? And do we win? Do we win the bottle of wine this week? You know, or do they win it? And we thought, we'll just let them win it. You know, they were terrified.
It's a two-part question, everybody. We want the name of the celebrity, but also his character's name in Kingsman. So there you go. And right now people are guessing, but not guessing correctly, or not giving us the full answer. Not going to give it away until I see the full answer, everyone. And Dave is holding back, and he'll have the answer for you shortly. But yeah, I love pub trivia. And it's always a compliment to me when my friends are like, hey, you're good at this. Can you join us? We're going to do it. I miss pub trivia. Fred Van Lente, the fine writer, would run a lot of bar trivia nights.
Oh, really?
And he's been doing it on Word Balloon. So on Friday nights, I've been having him on. And it's me and the audience playing together as a team.
One of my brothers and I got super competitive with it. And we used to start bringing people we weren't even friends with to be on our team. I'd bring somebody who was an expert in geography or something like that to be on my team because I knew there was a geography question. So, you got to let it go sometimes.
Understood. I'm sorry. I keep reading answers. I want a name, kids. You can't tell me what he does. That's not a name. I need a name, please. So that's interesting. Very funny. There we go. Kevin K. Wright, I believe, has the correct answer. Let us make certain. By hearing Dave Gibbons' answer for it.
So, did you get the answer? The answer is, of course, Mark Hamill, and the character's name is Professor Arnold. If you said Mark Strong, you're wrong.
All right, put that glass down, Dave. Yeah, I think you're drinking a little too much. But yes, indeed, it was. Let's see. I want to make sure I get through. Yes, Kevin K. Wright has the correct answer. Kevin K. Wright, everybody. So Kevin K. Wright, my email is john@wordballoon.com. I expect to hear from you, and that better be your proper name or we're going to have an issue. But we want to be able to send you a lovely brandy snifter from the fine people at Wiggle Liquor. I feel like there's an old baseball announcer. Wiggle Liquor, everybody. Have one on us. Boy, oh boy. They had they sent bottles of rye and bottles of bourbon, and I wish I could send them. But I don't think you can send booze through the mail. I think that's an issue. And we don't want to get arrested, but we will send glasses. So Kevin K. Wright, congratulations. You got it right. Mark Hamill and Professor James Arnold is the correct answer. So very good. There's another question coming. It is tough. And I won't tell you the celebrity is, but we're not playing around, man. They're going to make you work for this. I don't know if we're going to give a second snifter away. And I was mad. I let them kind of ask their own questions. But it was great. It was lovely that Dave did that. I should point out, Dave Gibbons being interviewed tomorrow by Tom King, a one-on-one conversation. It's going to be great here on Baltimore Comic Con. But anyway, this cast for Jupiter's Circle, man. Circle? Man, I just keep worrying that I'm going to say it wrong.
It's Jupiter's Legacy.
Oh, Legacy. See, I am saying it wrong. All right, Jupiter's Legacy. Yes, indeed.
So nobody can fire you. That's fine.
You got Josh Duhamel. You got Leslie Bibb. I mean, they're the name actors that I can think of right away. That are part of this cast, and right now I've got the IMDb page open. Unfortunately, Mark, I know our friends at Netflix sent me a nice little cheat sheet, but I think the cast is being listed in order of appearance,
right?
Rather than their characters. But it's great, and much like what we've seen already from things like The Boys and Watchmen and stuff, it's great that you've got some recognizable celebrities to come in and be these legacy characters in the sense of like Josh Duhamel, who was always great. I think Leslie Bibb is fantastic always. So you're pleased with the casting and how everything's going?
That's amazing. I mean, like Stephen DeKnight, the original showrunner, did the casting, and he's got such an eye for it. He did season one of Daredevil, and the casting on Daredevil is just spectacular. It's brilliant. And I knew we were just in good hands. So he would send me the audition tapes of everybody, just, you know, as a courtesy, just saying, like, here's who I'm looking at, and here's who I'm going to choose, you know. And he had some brilliant, brilliant people. I'd say there's about seven standout performances. You know, luckily, if you're lucky in a show, if you get two, and there's like seven really good ones. You know, the younger people can sometimes be the weak spot. You know, the people who are around 20, if they're in a scene with somebody in their 50s who's got 35 years acting experience. But the people, like Elena Campouris is like unbelievable. She's going to be a movie star for the next 30 years. You know, she's absolutely incredible. But I think people don't quite know what they're in for here. You know, this is something special. It looks great. And the actors are just world class, really.
Has the fact that the TV writers are playing with your characters or the performances themselves, have they made you take a second look at your characters and maybe bring something else to the news? Well, the news story is set in the future, so I don't know how many of these characters are going to show up, but again, you might still be playing a timer or whatever.
There's just a couple. It's actually quite nice. So I only have the voice of my character instead of the voice of an actor generally. You know, Kick-Ass was a little different actually because, you know, by the time I was on Kick-Ass 2, Kick-Ass 1 was being filmed, you know, so I met Aaron and Chloe and all the guys, you know, so you kind of did get a little confused as you were writing. You would sometimes, instead of seeing the drawing, you would see the person. But the beauty of this being a generation on is, no, it's not an issue, you know. So you've got to always think of the comic first, otherwise you end up with a bad comic. You know?
Prior to you making the deal with Netflix, I don't know where Kingsman 3 was in development, and I don't know how much you were able to work on that. Were you able to work on that?
Even Kingsman 2. I mean, I started the company sale. We actually had, we were talking to some people back in 2016, and Kingsman 2 was being put together at that point. So I had no time to work on Kingsman 2. So I was an executive producer, which meant I could go in. I talked to Matthew about the script, and then I could go in and watch edits of the film and give notes and everything. But I wasn't able to have anything like the involvement I had in Kingsman 1. I had no time to write the book. Certainly there was no book for it. Kingsman 3, I can't work on at all, which is, in some ways is kind of sad. I feel like Jor-El waving Kal-El off into space and just hoping for the best. But, you know, Matthew is like the Kents, isn't he? Like, it's fine. It's landed in good hands. Everything's okay. How dark it's getting in Scotland here. I'm going to try and get a little bit more light. Let me
just okay, buddy. No problem. I mean, you know, we see the sun, but you're good. Oh, there you go. Oh, that's good. It's very, very atmospheric.
I know. I look a bit sinister suddenly now.
You always look sinister. Don't kid yourself. You know that. Jesus. Oh, that's so funny. This is interesting. Now,
yeah.
Oh, no, I don't think that, well, Steven said Ultimates deserves much more credit for being the backbone of the Marvel Cinematic Universe. You know, Mark, I've been another comic book friend in the last couple of years has been your Ultimates collaborator, Brian Hitch. And it's been really fun talking to him as well about how what you guys set up exploded on the screen. And really, I mean, that first Avengers movie and a lot of what we see in the DNA of the cinematic universe absolutely came from the Ultimate Universe.
Oh, yeah. I mean, Marvel had never made a secret of it, though, you know. So I mean, they've always been very great about it, you know. So like I mean, we did the book. I started writing it in 2001, and you know, the book came out in 2002, and then the Marvel Universe really started in 2008. But you know, my friends who worked on it, like Zach Penn, I mean, he's publicly said essentially Avengers is his adaptation of issues 1 to 13, you know, and there's lots and lots of similar scenes and everything, you know. But which is great. I mean, it's the nicest compliment. I mean, but we never anticipated anything like that. You know, back in 2001, we were like, okay, Marvel have no money whatsoever. We're making less money than we got paid at DC up front, hoping that we were going to make some money on the back end. And it was just such a great opportunity working with people that we really liked and everything, you know, as opposed to thinking, okay, this is going to be a $1 billion franchise at some point, you know? So, I mean, for us, it was way beyond our wildest dreams. I mean, we just genuinely, when I came to Marvel in summer 2000, I genuinely thought, will Marvel still be here in a year's time? Because I don't know if you remember at the time, but the rumor was people's checks were bouncing and everything, you know. And I was working over at Wildstorm at the time, and I was making $150 a page at Wildstorm, which is a pretty modest sum. And Marvel offered me $100 to come over there. You know? And weirdly, I actually agreed to it. I was like, yeah, that sounds great. But just because I like Joe so much, and the idea of working with Joe was awesome. And then it obviously went crazy and everything worked out brilliant. You know?
No, and I was going to ask what was the appeal of coming to Marvel? Was it also more freedom to explore these characters? Was DC, and again, this is just a reader's perspective at the time, that maybe there were just more rules about how to write certain characters, and Marvel, given where it was, they were more like, hey, what do you got?
Yeah, I think each company goes through periods of being the cool guy and the conservative guy, you know? And I think, like, DC in the 80s was super cool. Marvel was cool in the 70s and the 60s and everything, but DC in the 80s, Alan Moore, Herb Chaik, and Frank Miller, you know, people were cutting loose and doing crazy stuff. But Marvel, it was like the Wild West in the 2000s. I mean, one beautiful thing about the company being on its knees was that they were ready to take a risk, which was brilliant. You know, we would never have got away with what we were doing in 1991 when Marvel was making money hand over fist, but Marvel was almost gone. So they said, look, let's get these idiots in and just see what happens. And that's as a writer, that's the most exciting thing that can possibly happen when people say, go and do what you want. And it worked out great. And DC was the complete opposite. I mean, DC in the 90s was like a prison camp or something. You know, I mean, it was dark. So, like, you would, you know, it was very corporate. And Marvel just suddenly felt like freedom. And I all my life, I wanted to be in DC. And then when I got there, I was like, I'm not really having a good time here at all. You know, I don't fit in with this thing. Whereas Marvel, I fitted right in. And I loved Joe and I loved Bill Jamis and Dan Buckley, who came in and replaced Jamis. And, you know, Bendis was great. And I worked with the most amazing guys like Hitch and Adam Kubert, Andy Kubert. I mean, it was just a dream. And then Johnny Romita and I became fantastic friends. We did Wolverine together. And that led to Kick-Ass and everything, you know. So my sort of 8 or 9 years that I was at Marvel was good times. You know, it was really, really nice. But I was always very aware, as every creator should be, you know, after, you know, Frank Miller had given this great advice, which was, you know, do Marvel and DC or whatever, build an audience and then take that audience with you and go on and do your own things. So I did have an exit plan as well at the same time. And I was aware that Hollywood were coming calling, and Hollywood were turning anything I was doing at Marvel into a movie, you know, so it was a nice logical next step for them to turn my stuff into films as well. So I appreciate the Marvel years for what they were just great fun. It was every 5-year-old, it's their dream, isn't it, to grow up and work for Marvel. And I was so lucky I got to do that for 8 years.
That's amazing, man. You know, someone earlier in the chat, I'm not going to scroll because we keep getting new questions, but someone had asked, would you ever want to go back to a DC property you did? And surprisingly, it was a Swamp Thing that they were asking about. And
oh my God, you know, never. Well, it was so bad.
Yeah, you know, so something bad.
Yeah.
I was going to say, honestly, I think people do overlook your Swamp Thing, and I think it was a fine run. So,
no, it was a perfectly decent run, you know, but it was so hard to write, you know? It was,
oh, really?
Oh, my God. But I loved it. I mean, I had fantastic editor, Stuart Moore, one of the nicest
guys. Oh, I love Stuart, absolutely. Yeah, you're 100% right, yes.
Yeah, the team I had at Swamp Thing was just fantastic. Julie Rottenberg, they were just lovely, lovely people. But it was actually really difficult. Like, I was really young. I was 22 when I got Swamp Thing, you know, so I was really young. And I wrote it for 3 years. And see, to get 36 issues or whatever, I wrote stories about a guy who's a plant, like a vegetable, right? And I wasn't allowed to cross over with the DC universe. You could write Batman or you could write essentially a talking houseplant. And he didn't even speak normally. Ellipses, those three ellipses every couple of words, you know. It was difficult. It was really hard. And I just tried to keep my head above the water the whole time. We were always in cancellation. I used to phone up Stuart every month and say, Stuart, are we cancelled? And he went, we're 500 above break even. And I somehow just kept my head above the water the whole time. But it was difficult, I've got to say. So I couldn't go back to that. Years down the line, though, I must admit, I would absolutely love to do another Superman project, like Red Sun. I'd do a run or anything like that, but Red Sun, I had such a great time on, and I would love to do another graphic novel, you know, just, you know, maybe 100 pages or something, do a big Superman project. I'd like to do one big Batman project, a Green Lantern. I've got really good ideas for some Justice League and things like that, but it'd be years before I can get to do them. But I've got notes. I mean, I've got millions of notes. I've got, like, a Green Arrow series and things in the back of my mind, you know, so over the years, I loved that stuff growing up. I mean, I absolutely loved it. So you can't help as an adult to just, you don't mean to, but an idea comes into your head for the elongated man or something like that, you know?
That's outstanding. Well, again, you're already predicting what's going to happen in 2026. So maybe something for the 2030s. we can look forward to that.
Maybe late 2020s, maybe. I think I could probably do
okay, there you go. That'd be great, man. Absolutely. And you'll come on work a little. We'll be senior citizens, and we'll still be talking about this shit. That'll be great.
This is so ridiculous, but I actually know what I'm doing up until about 2025. Like, I've got the month-by-month plan of it all, because in Netflix, what we have to do is we create the stuff as movies and TV shows first, and then I'll do the comic later, you know? So I need to know who's available. And yesterday I booked an artist for 2024. I booked him for 2024. And people sign five-year deals with Marvel and DC and everything.
I can appreciate that, absolutely. That's amazing. That's fantastic. Got our people are waiting to come on later, Mark. Mark's frozen right now, but I'll say it. We've got some very cool people coming up in the next hour, and I certainly see one of them, and it's good to see you, my man. I'll tease when it's time, but it's great to see you in the backstage area right now. One of my favorite guys. I haven't seen him in a long time. This is, again, thank God we got video right now, man, because really it's the heart, you know, the end of convention season technically. Mark's back. There you go. Yeah. All good, buddy. I was worried, but no, we're cool. That's great. We're gonna chat for about another 10 minutes or so, Mark. But no, it is great. As you were saying, you're lining people up for the next literally like 5 or 6 years, because people have exclusives and you got to catch them when their contract is up, obviously, to tap them to do something new. Was he frozen again? Son of a gun. All right, he'll come back. Don't worry about it. So, you know something? I will promote the next panel while we're waiting for him. Hey, look, everybody. He's going to join us at the top of the hour. I don't know if he can hear us. Can you hear me, Ryan?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Excellent. Yes, Ryan Stegman and Donnie Cates coming up in the next hour. It's a good opportunity to promote that. They're going to be talking about their great event that's going on in Marvel. Good to see you, buddy. How are you?
Yeah, you too. How are you doing?
I'm doing all right, man. Yeah, I appreciate you like jumping in right now. I don't mean to put you on the spot, but we got Frozen Millar here. Poor Mark stuck in the Phantom Zone.
He looks clearly great, though.
It does look great. So, good, man. I'm excited to hear your conversation coming up in the next hour. Are you talking to Amy Dallin? Is it Amy doing the panel?
I have no idea.
I forget. Oh, no. It's Christy Blanche. Excuse me.
Christy's oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah, I just saw her tweeting about it. Yeah.
Absolutely, man. From Aya Comics in Muncie, one of the best retailers out there. Mm-hmm. All right, Mark has popped out. We'll see what happens right now.
Just pretend to be Mark. Go ahead and ask your questions.
So, let's go back to Wolverine, Enemy of the People, and mm-hmm. Agent of S.H.I.E.L.D. What a great two story arcs that happened with you and Johnny Romita. What'd you think about that, Mark? Now you got to answer in a Scottish accent, obviously.
I can't do the Scottish accent at all. I don't think anybody can except Scottish people.
You know, go ahead.
Oh, I was going to say, working with John Romita Jr. was an honor. I mean, he's the second best artist of all time to Ryan Stegman, but, you know.
That's awesome. I was going to say, I love, and really, this is not meant in any insulting way, but there are times where Mark and I will talk, and I will be like, all right, I need you to repeat that because I didn't quite understand it. Because he'll get excited, and in his Scottish accent, and he's like, don't worry. And he told me a great story of when he was working at DC, he had an editor, and sometimes the guy would just, whatever he said, would just start laughing. Like, yeah, that's hilarious. That's hilarious. Right. One time he was telling him about how, it's been a really tough week. My uncle, who I was really close to, passed away. Yeah, that's hilarious. That's fantastic. And it's like, no, I don't think you understand what I was saying. And I'm like, yeah, I get it. That and I remember when Mark was on, like, Good Morning Britain, like one of their morning BBC shows. And it was – the BBC was going to run a Curse of Superman documentary. Mm-hmm. And it was great seeing Mark. And then I was teasing, here, he's back. Mark, I'm telling him, if you – there you go. It's all right, buddy. No. I was telling Stegman, I remember when you were on like Good Morning Britain and they were running the Curse of Superman reality show. And they had you on as a guest. And it was so fantastic. And I really enjoyed just watching so Mark, tell us all about Superman and all the terrible things that have happened to the actors that that played him and stuff. And it was great. And you're just like, and I don't know if you remember that television appearance or not, but it was outstanding. I loved it. It was one of my
the thing that was amazing about those days was nobody knew anything about superheroes, right? I mean, this was back in 2005, but now everybody knows everything about superheroes, which is great, isn't it? Like the world has finally caught up with the rest of us. But back then, I'd be like, well, there's this guy called Superman, and he dresses up as Clark Kent during the day, you know? Where now even my ancient aunties know that Tony Stark is Iron Man. It's awesome. I love this world that we're in there.
It's insane. Stegman, you were awesome pinch hitting there. I don't know if you want to ask Millar a question while we're sitting in Millar's pub.
No, I don't want to take up his time. I mean, you've got plenty of questions for him, I'm sure.
All right, buddy. Well, we're looking forward to your...
Ryan, I'm just saying hello to you here as well. I can just see his little face in the corner of the screen. Good to see you.
Nice to meet you.
And in 10 minutes, he and Donnie Cates are going to be talking about Venom and their big event that they've got going on at Marvel right now. So he gets the Marvel headaches right now, Mark. You see, you're free and clear right now.
Yeah.
So. Is it a big crossover scene, Ryan? Is it a big event book kind of thing?
Yeah, we're doing King in Black, that's what we're going to talk about. We just did Absolute Carnage. You can see it. I have my own posters in my room because I'm a narcissist.
Yeah.
But now we're doing King in Black.
That's awesome.
Are you tying in with other people tying into what you're doing?
Yep. Big time.
Oh,
we've
my
got
God.
A that, crazy amount of tie-ins.
It's the hardest job in the world, honestly. Like, I didn't appreciate it. Like, everybody says it. You know, the guys in the 80s, the 90s, and everything, mm-hmm. They're like, you will not believe how difficult it is because you're always going to run against somebody who doesn't do what you're planning to do and everything and stuff has to be redrawn. Oh, my. Have you encountered all that stuff yet? Yeah.
Oh, yeah. We did on Absolute Carnage. We definitely had some hiccups that, you know, didn't even get ironed out by the time publication happened. So.
But Civil War, honestly, I could only... That was my World War II. Even though it did well and everything, it was like the hardest experience ever. And I was so happy to see it drift off. Like, I had to read all the strips. People, there was maybe 50 tie-in books or something. It was just insane. And nobody was reading my original plot and everything. And I was having to try and kind of bend it towards the fill it, the tie-in books and everything. It was horrific. But I look back on it now and I just think it's a nice thing to have on your shelf.
You did a great job on it. Because honestly, I'm in the rooms when we pitch these stories and it's always brought up. We're just like, well, what did they do in Civil War when this happened? You know,
that's beautiful. Ryan, I can't wait. It's at the top of the hour. Yeah. I see Donnie and Christy backstage. I will let you prepare, but thank you very much for pinch hitting while we were having connectivity. And it was great having you and Mark talk for a moment. So thank you.
All right. Nice see you guys.
There we go. That's beautiful. And I want to squeeze in this last trivia question with one creator. I don't think anyone's going to get this, but I'll throw it out there.
Well, hello, Dr. Millar. 20 years ago, you and I were thrown together like a boy band to put together the ultimate Marvel Universe. And my fondest memory is what a gentleman co-writer you were on Ultimate Fantastic Four. More than I. So my trivia question for you is, what's my name? Oh, you know what? I have a real question. Real trivia question. How much is your Netflix deal worth? Okay, now I have a real trivia question. What was the last thing anyone said to you at DC before they kicked you out? I want to see if I can tap it.
Oh, hello. Little known fact, both Mark and myself, just a couple years ago became honorary doctors of our alma mater. And I only bring it up because it's annoying when I bring it up. So where did Mark get his doctorate from and what is it in?
Okay. Now, finally, literally he sends me these videos one at a time. I'm like, ask a real question.
I love
it. He's like, how about this? How about that? I'm like, it's driving me nuts. So we did get a real question. Go ahead.
You know the real answer to this is emergency ear, nose, and throat surgery.
Good. I got a skin tag I want you to look at when we're done. It's going to be appropriate for video right now, but I'll, But this is a really, really hard question. So Mark and Brian were given doctorates, apparently, honorary doctorates from a real university. I've got the name here, and this was tough. I'm like, hey, how about, like, you want to actually give something away?
I got one from a real university. He got one from the American university. Come on.
Okay, but we're looking for Mark's university. So let's see. Oh, I believe Adam Anderson, everybody.
Yes.
Adam Anderson, congratulations. You have won a Bradby Snifter from Wiggle Whiskey, everybody. So that's fantastic. And good Lord, that's great because we're literally out of time. I'm so glad we got that in. Mark, we're all excited for Jupiter's Legacy coming in the spring from Netflix. Yeah. That's fantastic. And hey, man.
Don't forget the new Kingsman movie as well. New Kingsman movie out in February. So, you know, the perfect
balance. Yeah.
If you're in a relationship where you've not got much to say to each other anymore, it's the perfect night out. Go and see the new Kingsman movie. You can just sit in silence.
That's beautiful, man. Well, listen, the time always runs too short. So I guess we're going to have to continue this conversation on a future mainframe con or a future word balloon conversation coming 100%. Up in early 2021. Buddy, it's always great to see you. I'm so proud of you.
Chicago. As soon as the world opens up again, we're out of our cages, I'm going to be in Chicago. So we should get out for a proper pint in Chicago too, because I've got a lot of good pals out there, so I'm keen to see you.
Absolutely, buddy. You can count on it. Thank you very much, man. It's been a great hour. Cheers. Lovely to see you. And you and the family, stay safe and stay healthy.
You too. All the best, John. See you then.
Thank you very much. Mark Millar, everybody. Hope you enjoyed it. Coming up at the top of the hour, it's King in Black, and it's going to be a great conversation with Christy Blanche, Donnie Cates, and Ryan Stegman. I see them all right now backstage. Can't wait to share it with you here on Mainframe. We're going to take a little bit of a break. Feel free to refill if you want, and get ready for an excellent conversation with these three fine people. But for now, I'm going to say goodbye and also remind everybody, and Christy is a part of it, Christy Blanche, our moderator for the next hour. We got the live Ringos coming up 8 o'clock Eastern time in a different room. Please join us. And really, thanks a lot for watching.